Welcome to part one of our lecture series on gluconeogenesis. This tutorial will cover the four novel enzymatic reactions that can reverse the process of glycolysis and generate glucose from non-carbohydrate precursors. The production of glucose from non-carbohydrate precursors is an energetically expensive process for mammalian systems. It is only engaged during long-term fasting or starvation and is only engaged in a small subset of tissues. Specifically, the liver is the predominant location for gluconeogenesis, although the kidneys can also produce small amounts. During long-term fasting or starvation, glycogen stores within the liver are depleted, causing the liver to no longer be able to homeostatically regulate blood glucose levels from this source. This is when gluconeogenesis kicks into gear. The liver will expend large quantities of energy from fat to produce glucose and release it into the bloodstream. In this way, the brain and skeletal muscles can be supplied with quick energy. Recall that glucose is the primary energy source for brain tissue, as lipids do not cross the blood-brain barrier. Chemically, gluconeogenesis is the process of converting pyruvate, or a few other precursors, into glucose. 7 of the 10 enzymatic steps from the glycolytic pathway are used in this process. 3 steps of the glycolytic pathway are irreversible. Thus, gluconeogenesis must use novel enzymes to mediate these reaction steps. The other major non-carbohydrate precursors used to make glucose are lactate, glycerol, and alanine. After you learn the primary pathway of gluconeogenesis from pyruvate, we will explore how these other precursors enter into the pathway. The 3 irreversible steps of glycolysis are also the 3 key regulatory steps within the pathway: the hexokinase step, the phosphofructokinase 1 step, and the pyruvate kinase step. In this overview, the glycolytic pathway is outlined in green. The key regulatory steps that cannot be reversed during this gluconeogenic pathway, shown in red, include the pyruvate kinase step. To reconvert pyruvate back into phosphoenolpyruvate, pyruvate must first be transported to the matrix of the mitochondria, where it can be converted into the 4-carbon molecule oxaloacetate. Oxaloacetate can then be transported, a bit laboriously, back into the cytosol, where it can be converted into the 3-carbon molecule phosphoenolpyruvate. If you count transporting the oxaloacetate out of the mitochondria, 3 enzymes are required for this process. 2 novel enzymes are also required to convert fructose 1,6-bisphosphate back into fructose 6-phosphate and glucose 6-phosphate back into free glucose. Note that you have already learned about this last step in our section on glycogen metabolism. Yay! That means you only have 4 new enzymatic steps to learn. The most complicated part of gluconeogenesis is converting pyruvate back to phosphoenolpyruvate. So let's take a look at this process in a little more detail. This process takes the action of 3 enzymes: pyruvate carboxylase, located in the mitochondrial matrix; aspartate aminotransferase, located in the mitochondrial matrix and the cytosol; and phosphoenolpyruvate carboxykinase, located in the cytosol. Oxaloacetate and aspartate are intermediate compounds formed in the process. To convert pyruvate back into phosphoenolpyruvate, you will need to use 1 molecule of ATP and 1 molecule of GTP in the process. This reaction series will have to happen twice for each glucose molecule that will be made. The pyruvate carboxylase enzyme is required for the first step. This enzyme converts pyruvate into oxaloacetate. Note that oxaloacetate is a normal intermediate formed in the Krebs cycle. Thus, you will see this compound again. The pyruvate carboxylase enzyme requires biotin as a cofactor and has two major enzymatic functions. The first is carbon fixation from carbon dioxide, and the second is carbon transferase activity, placing the carbon dioxide that has been fixed onto the molecule of pyruvate to create oxaloacetate. Biotin is a water-soluble vitamin known as D-biotin or vitamin B7 and is a cofactor in many enzymatic reactions, especially those involving carboxylation or carbon fixation reactions. It is a part of the vitamin B2 complex and is an essential vitamin for mammals. Deficiency results in dermatitis, loss of hair, and neurologic symptoms. Different structural models for biotin are shown here. The biotin cofactor forms an amide linkage with the pyruvate carboxylase enzyme at a lysine residue. This creates a flexible linker region within the pyruvate carboxylase that is capable of dipping the biotin cofactor into the different catalytic domains of the enzyme to obtain the biological activity of the protein. Attaching the biotin to the enzyme requires the energy of ATP. To mediate the formation of oxaloacetate from pyruvate, the pyruvate carboxylase enzyme has two major catalytic properties. First, pyruvate carboxylase needs to fix carbon dioxide or bicarbonate when in solution to the biotin cofactor. The enzyme reaction in the first part of the mechanism is the biotin carboxylase activity, and it requires the energy of ATP. Here, you can see that an oxygen from the bicarbonate mediates nucleophilic attack on the outer phosphate group of the ATP molecule, forming the carbonyl phosphate intermediate and a molecule of ADP. The biotin cofactor that is bound to the enzyme then can mediate nucleophilic attack on the carbon of the carbonyl phosphate intermediate. This forms the carboxybiotinyl enzyme complex and releases the inorganic phosphate that was harvested from the ATP molecule. The biotin is now loaded for the second enzymatic reaction. The carboxytransferase activity is housed in a separate domain of the enzyme and requires the formation of a carbanion intermediate to occur on the pyruvate molecule to make it reactive enough to cause the addition of the carboxyl group. A base from the enzyme eliminates a proton from the C3 position of the pyruvate, causing the formation of an enol intermediate. As the electrons from the oxygen of the pyruvate molecule reform the carbonyl group, the electrons from the carbon-carbon double bond shift onto the carbon, creating a reactive carbanion intermediate. At this point, the carboxybiotinyl enzyme complex swings into the carboxytransferase domain, providing the carboxyl group that will need to be incorporated into pyruvate. The carbanion intermediate mediates nucleophilic attack on the carboxyl carbon from the BCCP complex, and carbon dioxide is transferred to the pyruvate, creating a molecule of oxaloacetate. The biotin cofactor is restored by the donation of the proton from the basic residue in the enzyme. This also restores the pyruvate carboxylase enzyme for another round of activity. To make things even more complicated, the overall structure of the pyruvate carboxylase is a tetramer that contains four functional protein subunits. Two subunits are shown in color on this diagram, with the other two indicated in gray in the background. Each subunit contains a biotin carboxylase domain, shown in blue, a carboxyl transferase domain, shown in yellow, and the biotin carboxyl carrier protein, the BCCP domain, shown in red and green. The biotin carboxyl carrier protein domain is a flexible arm of the protein structure that can swing from one catalytic domain to the other catalytic domains during the reaction process. As shown in the diagram, the BCCP1 domain of subunit 1 will be fixed with carbon dioxide at the biotin carboxylase domain from subunit 1. The BCCP will then translocate to the carboxytransferase domain of subunit 2, where it will create one molecule of oxaloacetate and reset the biotin cofactor. The BCCP will then swing into the biotin carboxylase domain of subunit 2, where carbon fixation will occur. BCCP will then shift to the carbon transferase domain of subunit 1, where it creates a second molecule of oxaloacetate and resets the biotin. While this is going on with the BCCP from subunit 1, the other BCCP arms from subunits 2, 3, and 4 are also active. Thus, one full sequence of enzyme activity will produce 8 molecules of oxaloacetate. In looking at the space-filling diagram of pyruvate carboxylase, the central region of the protein that extends to the BCCP domain is also an allosteric region of the protein. When pyruvate enters the Krebs cycle, it is first converted to acetyl-CoA. If abundant pyruvate is present, then ample supply of acetyl-CoA will also be available, indicating a high energy load for the cell. Acetyl-CoA can bind with pyruvate carboxylase and act as an activator of the protein, stimulating the production of oxaloacetate. ADP, on the other hand, is a low-energy indicator and an inhibitor of the enzyme. In the next section, we will discover how oxaloacetate finds its way into the cytoplasm.